Hello, doctors. I hope you all are doing great. Today, we will study the skull, more precisely, the interior of base of skull. As you can see, this is skull. For orientation, this is its interior aspect, known as norma frontalis. This is its lateral aspect, known as norma lateralis. This is its posterior aspect. And this is the base of the skull, known as norma basalis. This is interior of base of skull, which we study today. I have removed the vault of the skull, so now the interior of the base of skull is fully visible. So the bones we can see here are frontal bone on the frontal aspect. Laterally, we have temporal bone and parietal bone. Posteriorly, we have occipital bone. This is ethmoidal bone, and this butterfly or bat shaped bone is sphenoidal bone. So the cranial cavity is divided into three fossas. Interior fossa, that is the shallow one. This hole is anterior fossa. This is middle fossa, that is deeper than the interior fossa. And this is the posterior fossa. The posterior cranial fossa is the deepest of all. So firstly, we study the interior cranial fossa. The anterior border of anterior cranial fossa is formed by frontal bone and the posterior border by the sphenoidal bone. This is the body of sphenoid bone. This one is the lesser wing of sphenoid bone on the both sides. And this is the greater wing of sphenoid bone on the both sides. This one is the lesser wing and this is the greater wing. So the posterior boundary of the anterior cranial fossa is made by the lesser wing of sphenoid bone. Now, this is the frontal crust. You can see, this is the frontal crust. This one. And as we go posteriorly, this is foramen cecum. This is the cribriform plate of ethmoid bone. Perforations of the cribriform plate of ethmoid transmits olfactory nerves. It has many foramina in it. Okay, many foramina that transmit olfactory nerves. Now this sharp blade-like elevation is known as crista gallae. And these prominences are the superior part of the orbit. So these are the orbital part of frontal bone. This and it covers the major portion in the anterior cranial fossa. So up till now we have studied the frontal crust, foramen cecum, cribriform plate of the ethmoidal bone and crista gallae, and orbital part of frontal bone. That is the superior surface of orbit. Now comes to the middle cranial fossa. The bone which separates the middle cranial fossa from anterior cranial fossa is lesser wing of sphenoid bone. So the interior border of middle cranial fossa is formed by the lesser wing of sphenoid bone. And the posterior border of the middle cranial fossa is formed by the petrous part of temporal bone. This is the petrous part of temporal bone. And this is the squamous part of temporal bone. This is the greater wing of sphenoid bone and this is the lesser wing of sphenoid bone and this is the body of sphenoid bone. Now comes to the middle cranial fossa. The interior boundary of middle cranial fossa is made by the lesser wing of sphenoid bone. Lesser wing of sphenoid bone separates the anterior cranial fossa from the middle cranial fossa, and the posterior boundary of the middle cranial fossa is formed by the petrous part of temporal bone which separates it from posterior cranial fossa. So these are the boundaries of middle cranial fossa. Now here is the sulcus chiasmaticus. The sulcus chiasmaticus is related to the optic chiasma. When we go lateral to the sulcus chiasmaticus, here comes the optic canal on the both sides, and the optic nerve, that is cranial nerve 2, passes through the optic canal. While going posteriorly to the sulcus chiasmaticus, here is an elevation that is known as tuberculum cella. And then there is a depression known as cella tertica or hypophyseal fossa, where the pituitary gland rests. And posterior to it, the posterior boundary of the cella tertica is formed by the dorsum cella. So closely, this is sulcus chiasmaticus. Lateral to it is optic canal. There is an elevation posterior to it known as tuberculum cella, and then depression known as cella tertica or hypophyseal fossa. Then again, this is the elevation known as dorsum cella. And lateral to it are two projections known as posterior clinoid processes. Okay, we also have anterior clinoid processes, where the lesser wing of sphenoid and there is a projection on both sides known as anterior clinoid processes. These both are anterior clinoid and these are posterior clinoid. These are optic canal and this is hypophyseal fossa. Now you can see between the lesser wing of sphenoid and greater wing of sphenoid, there is a fissure known as superior orbital fissure. When we pass the probe through it, it opens into the orbit. And the cranial nerve 3, 4, ophthalmic division of 5th cranial nerve and 6th abducens nerve passes through this superior orbital fissure and it is present on the both sides. Now there are plenty of foramina in the middle cranial fossa. When we go posteriorly to the superior orbital fissure on its medial aspect, let me show you this medial and posterior. Medial aspect of superior orbital fissure and posterior to it, there is a foramen known as foramen rotundum. Maxillary division of trigeminal nerve, that is 5th cranial nerve, passes through foramen rotundum. So through superior orbital fissure, oculomotor, trochlear, ophthalmic division of trigeminal and abducens nerve passes. And through foramen rotundum, maxillary division of trigeminal nerve passes. Now when we come posterior and lateral to the foramen rotundum, here comes another foramen known as foramen ovale. And the mandibular division of trigeminal nerve passes through foramen ovale. Now again, posteriorly and laterally to the foramen ovale, here comes another foramen known as foramen spinosum. And no cranial nerve passes through foramen spinosum. However, middle meningeal artery passes through it. Now there is another foramen known as foramen lacerum that is present between the body of sphenoid and petrous part of temporal bone here. This is the petrous part of temporal bone and this is the body of sphenoid and between it is foramen lacerum. Deep petrosal nerve and greater petrosal nerve combines here to form nerve to pterygoid canal. And the other thing you should know about foramen lacerum is that internal carotid artery passes along it, not through it, along it. Another clinical significance of middle cranial fossa is that it is the most common site of fractures as it have many foramina in it and so easily prone to fractures. So up till now in the middle cranial fossa, we have studied its boundaries. Anterior boundary from lesser wing of sphenoid and posterior by petrosal part of the temporal bone. Then we have body of sphenoid, we have sulcus chiasmaticus, tuberculum cella, hypophyseal fossa, dorsum cella, posterior clinoid processes, anterior clinoid processes, superior orbital fissure, foramen rotundum, foramen ovale, foramen spinosum and foramen lacerum. And I have told you earlier the contents, its contents and the nerves and fractures passes through it. So this is all about middle cranial fossa. Now comes toward posterior cranial fossa. So the boundaries of posterior cranial fossa, anteriorly as you can see, it's the petrous part of temporal bone and posteriorly occipital bone. This inclined surface of occipital bone is known as clivus. that starts from the dorsum cella and ends at the foramen magnum. This huge foramen is known as foramen magnum. Now, this is the petrous part of temporal bone, and this is anterior surface and this is posterior surface. This is internal acoustic meatus piercing the posterior surface of petrous part of temporal bone, and the facial nerve, that is cranial nerve 7, and vestibulocochlear nerve, that is cranial nerve 8, passes through internal acoustic meatus. Now, jugular foramen, this is jugular foramen that lies between the petrous part of the temporal bone and condylar part of occipital bone. This is the condylar part of occipital bone. This is the condylar part. And this is the petrous part of temporal bone. Between it is jugular foramen, and it is on both sides. Internal acoustic meatus is also on both sides, and jugular foramen is also on both sides. And the cranial nerve 9, 10, and 11 passes through it. 9 is glossopharyngeal, 10 is vagus, and 11 is accessory nerve. The all of 3 passes through the jugular foramen. And this is foramen magnum. It medulla oblongata, meninges, the spinal part of accessory nerves, and vertebral arteries passes through foramen magnum. Now, posteriorly, this is internal occipital crust, and this is internal occipital protuberance. Internal occipital crust divides the posterior cranial cavity into two fossa, cerebellar fossa, where the cerebellum rests. So, this is all about posterior cranial fossa. Yes, this S-shaped groove is for sagittal sinus, and this groove is for petrosal sinus, on both sides. This groove is for transverse sinus, and this groove is for occipital sinus. Yes, we also have hypoglossal canal on the lateral side of foramen magnum, through which 12th cranial nerve passes. 12th cranial nerve is hypoglossal nerve.